Hello everyone. In my previous videos, you'll have seen this third-person view I created. This provides a much nicer presentation compared to recording what I'm seeing inside of the headset. This is also a nice setup if you want spectators to watch what you're doing, or if you want to present something entirely separate from what the player using the headset sees. So, let's have a look at how this system works. Before we get into this, I wanted to let everyone know that Godot is looking for submissions for their next showcase video. If you are working on an i6R project, why not submit a video? And our Godot XR Community Game Jam is being held this week. Maybe you can use the information in this video to your advantage. Okay, here we can see the main scene that we've created so far in our tutorial series. It contains our VR player setup, and the world the player moves around in, and of course our little obstacle box. We want to keep using this scene as is on devices like a Meta Quest or Pico or any other standalone device. However, with PC VR, we also output a view to the monitor. By default, we reproduce what the player is seeing. But we have control over this. We can change this to a spectator view. As I've already set this up, we're going to review this implementation. I have a spectator folder in which we can find the spectator view scene that we will be using. Before we take a look at that scene, we first need to make a change in our project settings. In our Run tab, we can see that our main scene is set to our, well, main scene. We want to keep this for mobile devices, but we want to use our spectator view scene for desktop. We select the main scene option and select mobile from the feature drop-down list. Now we press add. We now have a new main scene entry specific to mobile devices. We copy over our main scene into this field. And we change the original to our spectator view scene. Now our main scene is used on mobile devices, such as the Quest, and our spectator view scene is used on PC. So, let's look at our spectator view scene. In this scene, we find a subviewport called HMD. This is the viewport we will be using to render the view the player sees inside of the headset. It has a default size, but that is just for use in the editor. This size, as well as other important properties, will be set by the XR system when your game runs. Underneath this viewport, we can see that we've added our main scene as a child scene. This allows us to run our full XR experience as before. And because this is placed here, our XR camera will be used for this viewport. Note also that as a result, our initialization script on our main scene will now configure our HMD subviewport instead of the main viewport. We have turned editable children on for this node, but this is only so we have access to these nodes. We haven't actually made any changes. As you can see, our entire main scene is visible under this node. With the HMD viewport in our scene, we no longer have any output going to the monitor. So, we can see that we have a bunch of additional nodes at the top of our scene that control this output. This includes a new 3D camera used to render output to the main viewport, and a number of additional 2D controls, hence seeing some output in the 2D tab of the editor. This is just an example. You could do something entirely different here if you so choose. Our main node here is this third-person camera at the top. This is the camera that results in the third-person view shown at the start of this video. Note also the little camera object here. This allows us to visualize the camera position inside of the headset, so I know where to look when recording my videos. It is important to note that for 3D nodes, their visibility is not dependent on where they are placed in the node tree. Our third-person camera will render our 3D environment even though the nodes are part of the main scene that is placed within the HMD viewport. Visibility is controlled by the 3D layer system. We set these up in our Project Settings window. We find them in the 3D Render section under Layer Names. We have four layers currently set up. Layer 1 is our default layer, and everything gets placed into that by default. This we keep visible for all cameras. Layer 2 is for objects visible inside our headset only. Layer 3 is for objects visible for our spectators only. And Layer 4 is for objects visible in our first-person view only. We'll look at that in a bit. In order to make this work, we need to configure these layers for each camera. When we go back to our main scene and look at our XR camera, we can see that we only have the default and HMD-only layers selected. Back in our spectator view scene, we can see that on our third-person camera, we have our default and spectator layers selected. Finally, on our stabilized camera, we can see that our default and first-person view layers are selected. Note here that my camera object is not visible in the preview of our stabilized camera. I only wanted this camera to be visible in the headset. As I mentioned before, it's only there so I can make sure I'm looking at the camera while recording the tutorial videos. When looking at the camera scene, we can see that this contains a number of mesh instance nodes. If we examine these nodes, we can see that each are set to layer 2, our HMD-only layer. Note that I've also excluded these from the spectator view, even though it's placed behind the actual camera and isn't visible at all. This is just for safety, as our camera displays the content of the main viewport to the user, and we would get a cyclic error if we attempt to render it in that same viewport. Back in our spectator scene, we can see that I've added a script to the third-person camera. We expose an export variable in this script called lookAtNode, which we set to the head node. This head node is a child node of our XR camera. When we look at the script, we see our definition of the export variable. And then in our process function, we check if we have a value and use the lookAt function to make our camera look at our player. This makes the camera track the player walking around the scene. The other setup in our spectator scene creates an inset frame that replicates the view the player sees. We could use the actual render result of the player here, however, that often results in a fairly shaky display. Instead, we render to a separate viewport with a third camera that gets positioned where the player's head is, but with pitch removed and head movement smoothed to remove the shakiness. As we're dealing with 2D nodes here, these are only output to the containing viewport and not visible anywhere else. The frame node is a color rect that creates a small border around our display. Underneath, we have a viewport container. This is a node that will output the contents of a subviewport to the underlying viewport, making our render visible. Our first-person viewport then is this subviewport that we render to. And our stabilized camera is the camera used by this viewport. Currently, we have placed our stabilized camera in the same location as our XR camera. But to keep it in the right position, we'll need to add a bit of code. We can see that the script on our stabilized camera has two export variables. The XR camera variable identifies the XR camera that we'll be tracking. And the smooth delay variable allows us to control the smoothing amount that stabilizes our view. In the code, we can see our two export variables and we see a variable that keeps track of our previous transform. In our ready function, we'll give our previous transform its starting value provided an XR camera was set. The real magic happens in our process function. This is where we'll update the position of our camera. We start by making a copy of the transform of our XR camera. We then use the lookingAt function to remove pitch from the camera. We do allow the camera to tilt up or down and yaw from side to side, but we want to ignore pitch. Now we use lerp functions to smoothly change our previous transform to our new transform value. We do all this in the local space of the camera so that we only smooth physical head movement, not virtual movement. This was the issue with the hands lagging behind in my previous tutorial video. That is now fixed in this code. We do need our camera position in global space, so we take the transform we calculated and we apply the camera's parent global transform. Finally, we copy our new transform to our previous transform so we can use it next frame. We also have a field of view slider that allows us to adjust the field of view of our first person camera. We can see that its default value is 75 degrees, which matches the setting on the camera. We have a script on our spectator scene. Looking at the node setup, we can see that our value change signal is connected to a method on this script. We simply assign the new value to our camera's FOV. We also ensure we have the correct starting value in our ready function. And that is our full setup. Now you can replace this with anything you'd like to output to screen. You could combine the third-person view with a track camera and the green screen. Or you can let the user select between using the third-person camera or the stabilized camera instead of using the inset. Or it doesn't have to be a spectator view at all. It could be a completely different interface. A great example of this is a game like Keep Talking and Nobody Explodes, which shows a completely different UI to the user sitting behind the monitor than what the user wearing the headset sees. And with that, we can show all the parts working together. Our third-person camera nicely tracks our player, while our inset shows what our player is seeing. As always, if you found this video useful, I'd appreciate a like. You can also subscribe to my channel to be notified of new videos. Or become a member, that is always greatly appreciated. That is all for today. See you next time.